Ready for our date night to the movies?
Yeah.
What do you want to go see?
I'm in the mood for something scary.
Well, there's that new Gretel and Hansel movie. Invisible Man was supposed to be good. Oh, wait, maybe Candyman's out.
I want to see something really scary.
Well, there's this classic movie theater doing showings of Halloween and Psycho.
Not scary enough. This is what I want to go see.
No. No, anything but that. No! Hello, Internet! Welcome to Film Theory, the show that's always worth the price of admission, because the price is free. It's no secret that social distancing has hurt a lot of businesses. Restaurants, sports, theme parks. I mean, that creepy dude who sits on my street corner always selling hand sanitizer is killing it right now.
Want some lotion?
But other than him, I think a lot of us are feeling it. And none may be worse off than the movie theaters. Across the globe, theaters have been closed for months now, or at the very least have been operating with heavily reduced seating. Studios have delayed the theatrical releases of all their biggest films. Reports are even coming out that AMC, the largest movie theater chain in the world, is on the cusp of filing for bankruptcy, which they better not do because A-List is like my favorite thing in the world. But the financial problems for movie theaters didn't begin with social distancing, and they certainly won't end once social distancing is lifted. On the surface, it seems weird to say that movie theaters are in trouble, right? After all, each year we see box office records being smashed by one Disney-owned property or another, but while a select number of blockbuster movies might be killing it at the box office these days, fewer people are going to the movies overall. U.S. movie ticket sales hit a 25-year low in 2017, despite that year having massive movies like Spider-Man Homecoming, Wonder Woman, Thor Ragnarok, Guardians of the Galaxy 2, The Beauty and the Beast remake, Despicable Me 3, and The Last Jedi, which, you know, mattered since that was before people started hating on Star Wars again. If you have a killer lineup of movies like that all in the same year, and you are still struggling to sell tickets, bro, there's something definitely wrong. And in the case of theaters, there's a lot wrong. The first problem is the trend of the rising cost of movie tickets. Ticket prices today are 109% higher than they were back in 1995, which you would expect some level of price increase, but it is still far outpacing inflation. And those higher prices are making audiences a bit choosier about what movies they're gonna go see in theaters and what movies they're gonna go ahead and watch at home via video on demand. So movie theaters find themselves caught in a bit of a catch-22. Fewer ticket sales means that they have to have higher ticket prices in order to make up for that lost revenue, but in return, higher ticket prices cause fewer ticket sales. Also, because the movie theaters are so dependent on big blockbuster movies nowadays, they're very susceptible to flops. According to Thrillist, quote, "Studios get around 90% of the revenue from a movie in its first week of release, which diminishes over subsequent weeks, with more money going to the theaters," end quote. In other words, movie theaters depend on movies to succeed and draw audiences for multiple weeks, because on week one, they're not making much off of those ticket sales. It's only in the later weeks that those tickets are making them much money, but that sort of arrangement puts theaters in a dangerous position. If a blockbuster is a flop and audiences taper out after that opening weekend, then the movie theater is losing out on what could have been the most lucrative weekends for them. It's not as though there's a new blockbuster for them to offer every weekend either. As the major film studios continue to gobble each other up, fewer big studios mean fewer big movies. According to Business Insider, quote, "The number of wide releases by the six major studios, Warner Brothers, Walt Disney, 20th Century Fox, back when that was still relevant, Paramount Pictures, Sony Pictures, and Universal, has been on a downward trend since 2006, end quote. The other problem with this pricing model, as it concerns theaters though, is how we consume movies these days. With more emphasis on blockbuster movies, there's more pressure to see those movies as soon as possible, so you can be a part of the cultural conversation, or simply to avoid spoilers. I mean, thanks to social media, half the planet knew the ending of Infinity War like that. Oh shoot, no, don't dust away, no, I come back, I wasn't snapping in the, oh damn it, I lose more backgrounds that way. Curse my reality-defying snaps. The long and short of it is that the need to consume content immediately means that opening weekends, the time when the theaters are making the least money, are huge, but subsequent weekends, when theaters stand to make more of that money, are actually much lower in overall ticket sales. And if all of that weren't already enough issues plaguing movie theaters, there's the shrinking theatrical window attacking them on the other side. The theatrical window is the period of time between a movie's release in theaters and when it's made available for home viewing on videotape, DVD, or streaming. The longer that theatrical window, the more incentive audiences have to go see the film in theaters. It's not like you're gonna wait 6 months to go see Endgame, but maybe you'd be willing to wait 2 or 3 months for it to show up on Netflix, right? Now, if it seems that the theatrical window has shrunk a bit over the years, it's not your imagination. It has. A couple decades ago, a typical movie would have a 5 to 6 month gap between its theatrical release and its home video release. As of 2019, the theatrical window is now 3 months. Studios would love to cut the movie theater middleman out of the distribution process altogether, keep all of that money for themselves, and they will do it if and when technology allows them to do it in a financially beneficial way. So movie theaters have been in trouble for a while, and they've been fighting an uphill battle against technological advancements like video on demand for decades. But now, here in 2020, all bets are completely off. Social distancing has thrown gasoline on this garbage fire. With theatrical releases compromised by the pandemic, studios are scrambling to find new and creative release strategies. Onward, for example, was made available for free streaming on Disney Plus less than a month after its theatrical release. Major films like Invisible Man and The Hunt skipped straight from theaters into immediate home premieres, and then there's Trolls World Tour, which called a complete audible and went on for a full digital release, bypassing theaters altogether. So the $11 billion per year question that we're asking today is this: has COVID-19 killed theaters as we know them? To answer this, we first have to consider two simple truths. One, there will always be people who value the experience of seeing a movie in the cinema and will be willing to pay a premium for that experience. And two, there will also always be people who spring for the cheapest option. As long as there have been movies, there have been teens eager to pay for whatever schlock is on the screen so they can make out in the privacy of the back row. Is that a thing that real people do, by the way, or is this just a lie that the media has been feeding me for years? Are real people actually doing this? Because I go to a lot of movies, and granted, I sit in the middle of the theater, so maybe I don't know what's going on in the back row. Maybe I don't want to know what's going on in the back row. Anyone in the comments, can you guys let me know? Is this a thing? Have you made out in a back of a movie theater? Just really curious. Anyway, regardless of whether that specifically is happening, there will always be teenagers who use the movies as an excuse to hang out with their friends in private, so they will always be there. Similarly, for as long as there have been movies, there have been cinema purists out there who love the smell of stale popcorn, love the strange stickiness on the floor that never seems to go away under their feet, and want the chance to experience the stories from their favorite directors projected onto the biggest screens possible in the lowest quality possible, because that gives them the authentic experience. You see, this one was filmed on 100% tanned lambskin. The graininess of the sinews of the skin make it that much more real. These are the types of people who ensure that the cinemas remain, at least in one form or another, for generations to come. But I emphasize in one form or another because movie theaters as we know them are indeed headed the way of the dinosaur. And yes, COVID-19 has hastened the demise of those theaters. But to truly understand why, we turn to our Exhibit A, Trolls World Tour. If you had told me 2 months ago that I was going to be making a film theory episode about Trolls World Tour, I would have assumed that you were, trolling me. But the way things have played out, well, Trolls World Tour, first off, is like the only thing to talk about, but two, Trolls World Tour has proven to be a downright historic movie. Wrap your head around that one, friends. It's already the most pre-ordered movie of all time, and it's the best-selling film over 3 days of digital release. Amazon Prime isn't as transparent with its revenue numbers as the theatrical box offices, and as a result, we don't really know how much the movie, which cost an estimated $100 million to make, has raked in so far. But what we do know is that for a period of time, it was the number one film on Amazon Prime, and that is irrespective of what that movie costs to rent. So put another way, Trolls World Tour cost $19.99 to rent online for 48 hours. It was rented more times than anything else on the site, including all of the far, far cheaper movies that were being offered. Even without knowing the revenue numbers, it's tough to frame that as anything other than a success. And that brings us to our first big change coming to a movie theater near you. If and when digital releases prove themselves more profitable to the studios, family films are going to be the first to ditch the theaters. The savings that video on demand offer to families are simply too huge. The average movie ticket price in the US is $9.11. Meanwhile, Trolls World Tour, one of the few real world examples available to us of a high budget movie with 100% digital release, costs 20 bucks on Amazon Prime or Google Play. It's not hard to see how this becomes cost effective for families in a hurry. A large popcorn costs about $8.50 at AMC. A large soda, more than $6. If you're a parent with two kids who both want snacks, you're dropping $30 on tickets alone, plus concessions. You're looking at nearly $100 for one night just to watch Trolls World Tour. Oof! That is a big oof. And let me tell ya, even though my little guy is still too young to go see the movies, something tells me that the joy of watching him experience the cinema is not gonna be worth the $100 price for admission. You think parents want the headache of wrangling up their kids for every movie that comes along, and then wanna pay a premium to go see Trolls World Tour? No! Video On Demand allows families to turn their living rooms into cost-effective movie theaters. Video On Demand offers a pause button for bathroom breaks. It offers parents the option to make popcorn in the kitchen for like 8.5 cents instead of $8.5. Video On Demand is cheaper, it's easier, and if studios figure out a way to make it more profitable, supply and demand will meet. It is the future of family movies. The second change you can expect to see at the movie theater is an unwelcome one: even higher prices. We discussed earlier how ticket prices have been rising for 25 years, outpacing inflation by a mile, and yet people keep ponying up for these higher ticket prices because over the decades, theaters have adapted and found new ways to make going to the movies an event. You already know what I'm talking about. I'm talking about 3D showings, Dolby sound systems, IMAX, 4DX showings with seats that vibrate and spray smells at ya. But for a lot of the audience, these gimmicks are wearing thin. 3D showings saw a huge surge in the aftermath of Avatar the Non-Airbender as they offered a reason for theaters to charge more for tickets. And they gave people a reason to go to the theaters again, because your home screen isn't gonna be projecting a 3D movie in quite the same way. But now, 10 years later, 3D is dying, if not already dead, just like it died in the 80s and in the 50s. People are over it, and fewer audiences are gonna be convinced about the value of a Dolby experience or an IMAX experience. Does slightly better sound make that much of a difference that it merits a higher ticket price? And let's face it, not every movie is gonna be conducive to a 4DX experience. Like, who's gonna pay extra to experience the 4DX smells of Little Women? They'll spray hay in your face. Seriously though, if I can stop the theory here for a second, Little Women was a great movie. In fact, it was one of my favorites of last year, and you should not sleep on it if you haven't watched it yet. It was wonderful. Just, you know, not a movie I could really cover on this channel. I mean, what would I theorize about? Was Marmee secretly a Confederate sympathizer? Yeah, hard pass. Anyway, we already know movie theaters are gonna have to raise prices in order to stay afloat nonetheless, and in a post-COVID-19 world, we can't expect any businesses, let alone theaters, to somehow cram more seats in closer together, so it's simple economics that brings us to the third, and perhaps the most significant change to movie theaters, the one that will kill theaters as we know them forever. We're gonna get fewer, but bigger theaters. First, understand that this was already a trend that was happening. In 1995, there were 7,744 cinema sites in the US. By 2018, that number was down to 5,869, and yet, the overall number of tickets sold didn't see anywhere near the kind of drop that you would expect over that time period. How is that possible? The Megaplex. The AMCs and Regal Cinemas of the world offer moviegoers dozens of movie screens in massive rooms in one theater complex. Thanks to streaming, audiences are strong, independent, and don't need no theater to go watch their favorite movie within a month of release. Movie theaters responded by offering a wider variety of movies than ever before. Megaplexes have put countless small theaters out of business over the years, and now it seems it's the Megaplex's turn to be put out of business. But by what? What's bigger than a Megaplex? I'll tell you exactly what. Stadiums. I can hear you in the comments. You think that your internet friend MatPat has gone crazy, but think of it this way. Way more people watch football games on TV than they do in person. But there are still enough fans out there that love the live experience to fill stadiums each and every week, right? Same thing with music. The vast majority of music gets consumed on demand by the consumer, not at live shows, and yet there are still enough music fans to fill up stadiums for rock concerts. See what I'm getting at? Sporting events do it, rock concerts do it, and soon blockbuster movies will do it too. Sure, you'll have smaller theaters to cater to the smaller indie movies, just like you have smaller clubs that cater to the smaller name bands, but for the big experiences, that's where the megaplexes will come in. Recently, a series of tweets went viral that overlaid audience responses to Avengers Endgame. The reactions sound like you're at a stadium. It's the same thing for watching horror movies in a theater. Movies are already skewing to those big, crowd-pleasing event moments, weaponizing our emotions so that, as a collective viewing group, we're all swept up in what's happening on the screen. That is what's making them feel like events. There will always be short-lived gimmicks here and there, but it's the emotion of seeing something happen with a bunch of other people that is the one true differentiating factor that no at-home experience can ever replicate. And what can do that better than the biggest screening venue possible, a stadium? Heck, for an example, just look at gaming competitions. They're holding video game competitions in stadiums as we speak. Esports arenas are a thing, and it's not because you can't get it online. Of course, those are streaming with better viewing angles, but it's because you want to be there and experience it live. Movie theaters have only survived this long because they've managed to make going into the movies an event. Times are only getting tougher for movie theaters, and that means they're going to have to pull off bigger and bigger events to stay relevant. The statistics don't lie. So you ready to watch the next generation of the Avengers in the Rose Bowl? You ready for Spider-Man 27 at Wrigley Field? If not, best start bracing yourself now, because it's happening. And you can make it happen a little bit faster with the help of our sponsor for today's episode, NordVPN. Now, I know what you're thinking. How could a VPN, which ensures your online activity remains anonymous, help bring about the end of theaters? I'll tell ya, unrestricted content. After months in quarantine, I bet you're getting bored, right? Heck, you were so desperate for a new movie, you even paid to watch Trolls World Tour. I know I did, and I am so ashamed. It feels like you've watched everything three times over, but that's not true. Sure, you've watched everything available in your home country three times over, but with NordVPN, you unlock global content. Things that aren't available here because of regional restrictions suddenly get unlocked with just the click of a button. Brooklyn Nine-Nine, which is the funniest show on TV right now and has been my favorite sitcom for the past 5 years or so, here in the US, it's on Hulu, which means you gotta pay, but it's available for free over on Netflix UK, which you can access with Nord in literally two button clicks. Change your IP, open Netflix. It is that easy. What about Family Guy? Well, that's available on Netflix Canada. Doctor Who? Netflix UK again. And I am just starting to explore Netflix Japan, which, according to my research, has the largest content library, which is really exciting. So I'll update you on what I find over there. Long story short, regional restrictions disappear thanks to Nord, because it has thousands of servers across 60 plus countries. And if you happen to participate in peer-to-peer sharing, using NordVPN disguises your IP address in the event that someone wants to, you know, talk to you about how they don't appreciate your sharing behavior. So if you're desperately searching for new content as you're not leaving the house for fear of viruses, Nord is not only protecting you, Nord is entertaining you. Best of all, Nord is a fantastic deal. Go to nordvpn.com/filmtheory, FILMTHEORY, and use the code FILMTHEORY at checkout to get 70% off a 3-year plan, plus one additional month free. That's nordvpn.com/filmtheory. Link is down in the description. You know that by now. Protect your internet browsing and protect your sanity both with NordVPN. Now, if you'll excuse me, I'm off to binge Community again. That one is finally available here in the US, Netflix US. And if Brooklyn Nine-Nine is my current favorite comedy, Community is my all-time favorite comedy. Might see a video about that one pop up on the channel soon. But in the meantime, remember, it's all just a theory. A film theory. And cut.